All right, so what is going on, YouTube? It's your boy Sam from Team Samurai X20 here. Who do we have here today?
Jesse Cotton.
Jesse, how are you doing today, bro?
We're doing good. We're doing good.
Honestly, the reason why I have you here is because I think you're one of the best light swords players on the planet. You know what I'm saying? I've known you for like over 10 years now. And I know light swords is like one of your favorite archetypes. Am I wrong?
It was the first meta deck I ever played. Yeah, like 15 years ago.
Okay, question. So how did you feel when you heard that light swords got new support for 2024?
Truthfully, I didn't think anything of it because every other time these old decks get support, or at least a lot of the times, it's just garbage to like gloss over. But when I read the cards and realized they were actually good, I was pretty excited. I was already started cooking, especially because they're really cool and open up a lot of avenues for the deck.
Okay, cool. So what's the best card in this deck right now, you think?
The best card in the deck? There's three new cards that are all just incredible. It's hard to almost tell which is the best. Lightthorn Dragonling might be the best one, though. The new Baby JD, it is phenomenal. I don't even use all of its effects that often because it's just that good.
So what are your thoughts on this deck right now in the current meta against Fire Kings, Snake Eyes? What are your thoughts behind it?
So the deck has potential viability. Its ability to play through hand traps is not bad. And you can gas through fields enough of the time that it's all right. And when you go first, your deck is incredibly powerful. It's non-linear. In the same way like a Snake Eye Ash may get in permanent, you pass, this deck won't have the type of problem. But you also are making fields that are stronger than a lot of other decks. So Boarbreaker is also undefective, and you'll see that as well. Although a lot of it does depend on how you build the deck. And because Lightsworn is just, at the end of the day, a mill engine, for the most part, you can build it in several different ways. On my channel, I talk about a tier version and a runic version, but today I have a different one for you. All three are viable, and there's potentially plenty more that I haven't even discovered or talked about yet. Go check out my channel, Jesse Cotton YGO, as well as on Twitch by the same name, but also check out TSX1.com, get the Supreme Pros, the sleeves we use. They are fantastic. And if you use Potato Tan, you're going to get 10% off site-wide. This is one of two brand new main deck monsters, Lightsworn Dragonling. What this card does is, when you have a Lightsworn monster in your graveyard, you can special summon from the hand for free. But then also, when it's special summoned, you can send any Lightsworn from deck to the grave. So you should be immediately thinking Wolf and Felice. Now it has one other bonus effect that doesn't come up in every version of the deck. It doesn't in this, but may in others like Tier. And that is, when it's sent to the graveyard, you can add any dragon with 3,000 attack and 2,600 defense from your deck to your hand. Now, if you haven't, you know, clicked that in your head already, that's Punishment and Judgment Dragon. So you can search those now very efficiently without having to play some sort of other Garnet. And that's pretty good. You can also use the Chain Block effects, because when you Synchro or Exceed with this or Link with it, it doesn't have to go from deck to grave like the other Lightsworn cards. It just has to go to the graveyard. And that's solid. But JD and Punishment are ultimately breaks, so unless your deck can really make good use of them, you don't want to play them in every deck. So the other really good brand new card is Vice. Shaman, this card is a common. My god, this is like the Sharon of the deck, the Tailment Sharon. What this does is you reveal it in your hand to activate it, and then you place any Lightsworn on top of your deck. You special summon it and email too. So, if you can see already, this is a great way of unclogging Wolf and Felice. And none of this requires a normal summon. You know, same with this. What I really like about these is these are both extenders that also generate another body, and both don't really require too much setup. Now they aren't like one card combos in the same way that like the Snake Eye cards are, but that's fine. We're not trying to play like a small Lightsworn engine. We're trying to play proper Lightsworns. And yeah, that's fantastic. Now it has another effect as well. And that is, when it's sent from deck to the grave, you can target a Lightsworn and special summon it. Both those effects are on its return. Same with the Dragonling. So unlike Wilf and Felice, you can't mill like multiple of these and trigger multiple of its effects, but it's fine. You'll still use both effects on the same turn relatively often. This sets up one card Minerva Synchro or Minerva Exceed plays, or any Synchro or Exceed, because none of these cards really restrict you. So yeah, very fantastic card, and a very, very a shame that it's a common. Hopefully no TS super soon enough. And I'm playing 6 Wolf and Felice. Now these clog a bit, but between Recharge and Charge Search and this, or just drawing Vice itself, you have many ways to get it out of your hand. It's not a big problem, and also complements other discard packages like the Horus cards. So then, while they're obviously not good to draw, you can make them work, and sometimes they are good with Vice. Now, the biggest thing here is, by playing these, it makes your mills just very powerful. Felice is incredibly good going second as well, because besides the fact that it's just a free body, it has the effect to tribute itself to pop monster on the field and then mill 3. So a great way to play through fields very aggressively, and then gives you the variation of tuner, non-tuner. Now, Wolf will trigger more often because it triggers up charge and recharge, where like this wouldn't. But they are both still very good. I still max out.
Oh, so that's why Weiss is so good, because if you happen to draw the bricks, you can place them back on top of your deck. So you just mill them, basically, right?
Precisely. All right, so the last Laser Watch I play is Gareth. I wanted one more name that I could search up charge. I think recharge life more often. You could play Raiden, you could play Lumina. Those are also decent options. There's nothing that really keeps up with the quality of these. But Gareth is okay in two removal-based formats, because if they don't clear this, and you start summoning cards like the Minervas, either the Synchro or the XYZ, or the Lightsworn Dragonlink, they'll trigger its effect to mill two and then draw cards, and even really see more of your deck faster, but then also just draw cards, which is broken. It doesn't love drawing. Drawing and milling are like people's favorite things in Yu-Gi-Oh! So Gareth helps you accomplish that, but this card is not fantastic. It's probably like the most cuttable card in here. So that's it for the monsters for Lightsworn, but you still play triple charge, triple recharge. You know, the thing is, even by like modern standards, these are above average cards. Like, Bonfire is broken and it's just Rota, but this is Nalan's per turn and it mills three. Just nuts. The fact that you can play this is just a big reason to play Lightsworn. And a recharge draw two mill two isn't as good as charge, but it's still fantastic. It fills the graveyard while cycling out some bad cards.
Amazing. So how come you opted not to play cards like Lumina, Lila, Raiden? You know what I'm saying?
There's not much back row in the format, so Lila doesn't do too much. I mean, you could argue that it's worth the side deck spot if you ever feel like you're playing with like Runic Stun type decks, and that has merit, so I wouldn't like auto exclude that from any lists. But I think in the main deck, it's not perfectly, like, it doesn't have a spot. Like, you're not going end phase mill three. That's not a viable strategy. You have to do stuff immediately on the first turn now. And, you know, end phase mill isn't going to cut it. Now, Lumina's also fine. The problem with Lumina is it requires you to set up. But Lumina's really good is if you play one or two copies, you can summon it off of Selene when you have three or more spells in the grave, which is incredibly easy to do because you're just milling a bunch anyways. And then you can change the axis of your levels. Right, because when you have all these level 4s in your deck and you're making level 4 XYZs, or rank 4 XYZs, and level 8 synchros, level 12 synchros, that's fine. If you want to access the 10s, 7s, or rank 3s, you want Luminas in the mix. So that is an option. It just happens that those levels are kind of worse, specifically with Baron being banned now. The 12, 8, 4 axis is better anyways, and it requires me not to have to play those cards. But Lumina is not the worst. Raiden as well would be the one to compete with this, right? Like, it just gets you going a little bit sometimes, and you can high roll with it, but ultimately isn't super high value. So then the last Lightsworn card is also brand new, and this one's okay, but I figure it's worth the spot, and it's Lightsworn Aegis. So you flip it up, you can use one once per turn, and you target cards your opponent controls up the number of Lightsworn monsters you control, and then it gets those card effects. So you can target any card, you can target spells, so it's the same as like Hot Red Dragon Archfiend, which is pretty good. And the reason why it's good and why you just play one of this is when it's sent from the deck to the grave, it can set itself. So it's kind of as if you roll through your deck, you end on one of these, and it pretty much just guarantees the combo goes through, because part of the combo will resolve on your opponent's turn, and this just pushes through board breakers. Specifically Subic Droplet. So that's the Lightsworn cards. I actually think there might be 20 cards exactly. There's 13 Lightsworn, 6 spells, 1 trap. Yes, should be 20 cards. So 20 card Lightsworn package, which is half your deck. And then the rest is just complementary stuff. I'll help you get through the deck faster. And now if you like milling, it should be no surprise the horse cards make an appearance. I'm playing 3 Kings Arc here because there's not too much back removal in the format, so it's pretty costly for decks to have to use their SP Banish on Sark, and I think that lines up pretty favorably. So if you want to use this as a powerful way to play through boards, I'd say max out 3 Sark, and you have the discards in this deck, so it's fine. But also, this just lines up well with rank 8s. Minerva Synchro into the rank, and then make someone a horse, make a rank 8 can be nice as well, so you don't get to access everything. Zombie Vampire is obviously not in mill decks, that should need no explanation. And then in mill decks, one of the best cards are Shufflers. These are great disruptions. What's also good about them is one of the tale as old as time problems for mill decks is you can't play too many combos that require pieces in the deck, right? Because if you mill the combo piece required in the deck, then the combo doesn't work.
Yes.
But with the Shufflers existing, it means that as long as you're going through enough of your deck, that you can consistently and reliably send a Shuffler to your grave, you can put those cards back to your deck. So these cards can act as disruption or ways to push through fields, hitting cards like Promethean Princess, but also as ways to ensure that you don't mill your combo out and screw up your deck that way.
Mm.
So these cards are fantastic, and obviously they are limited, so I have no option but to play only one of each. Debatable if you want to play more, but yeah, you should see these pretty often at 2 copies. And then I got some good old non-engine Kalbai and 3 talents. Now, I didn't want to have too much non-engine in here, and I figured this would just draw me more gas. To play Upstarts,
You're not scared of cards like Droll.
Droll, like, doesn't hurt the deck too much. You really don't draw search that much. The chance you draw multiple draw cards isn't super high. That happens as it happens, but, like, you can discard it for, like, King Sark still. You can do other stuff with this. It's not a huge deal. Mm. There's definitely other stuff you could go, but I just figured, like, too much non-engine could brick you. And if you draw more engine off upstart, the engine helps you play through your field. Otherwise, you wouldn't play a deck like this anyways.
Mm.
So I just want to make the deck more consistent, and that's where upstart fell in. You can also argue chicken game's good, but if you get stopped a bunch and you end up like a half field, but like they rip three cards for hand traps, I don't want to give them the chicken game now, because then that lets them keep up a lot more. And the last cards in the deck are the unique aspects, and that is Centurion cards. So another new Centurion card came out in this set, the level 12 synchro, and they line up very well with what Lightsworn cards do, and I'll explain why in the combos. But just know this is like how you actually make a good turn one. This is how you convert your bodies into something meaningful besides just like Apo IP.
Mm, okay, so you're mixing it with like a little bit of a small Centurion package.
Yeah.
So let me guess, like you're gonna make sure your opponent doesn't play on the first turn. Oh my goodness, okay, let's go on with the
action. What else could Centurion be good for?
Yeah, right.
So here we have the Mini Minerva Synchro. So if you aren't familiar with what this card does, is it says Lightsworn can be banished, and this is for Enlightenment Dragon. We don't play because we don't have Judgment or Punishment Dragon in the deck. However, it also comes up against SP, where they can banish your cards, so that's kind of cool. More importantly, though, when it's summoned, you can send Lightsworns of different types from your deck to the grave, even with the number of Lightsworns used for a Synchro summon. So usually it'll be two, sometimes it's one, but either way, send two Lightsworn different types from deck to grave. So importantly is Wolf and Felice, you can't send both. You can send one of that and one Vice. So it does make milling Vice a little worse, because you're pretty much always sending Vice via this anyways, and if you don't, this only summons back one monster. But if you're able to get two sends off this and then both resolve, then this pretty much is a free level 8 synchro that you pay nothing for, because the bodies replace themselves immediately. Also, what it does is you can banish any number or up to four Lightsworns from your grave and then mill that many cards. So again, continue with the whole plan of milling.
Yeah.
Now, the reason to play this is partially this new card, Centurion. Of course, Xyola, I think is the name, or Xyla. Honestly, I don't know what I think this is the new translation of it. But what this does is a generic level 12 synchro is on summon, lets you add a Centurion card into your hand. So unlike Legatia, which just draws a card on summon and the end phase gives you access to Centurion cards, this will give a non-Centurion deck immediate access to Centurion cards once you have level 12 access. And Minerva does exactly that, right? Because it's level 8 synchro that's then summoning a level 4 tuner. So immediate access to your Centurion package here.
Wow.
And this will get the field spell and then get rolling there. Now it also does something about protecting your back row from destruction, which is whatever. At the early end phase, you can place your graveyard Centurions back in the spell trap card zone. So this means you can synchro with the Centurions you put in the spell trap immediately, put them back, and then during your opponent's turn, synchro again. So you can make several level 12 synchros, and that's kind of where the deck is going.
Amazing, amazing.
So you're still going to play one Legatia, synchroing your opponent's turn for this card to pop and draw is still solid. Without hand traps, though, the draw is a lot less meaningful, unless you really need a Hail Mary to draw off this. It's really just okay. It's not anything like super crazy, but it's for sure still worth running as a value card when it comes out. Crimson Dragon is the real good card here. Targeting the level 12 synchro, bounce itself back, and summon level 12 dragon synchro. And the two options, we got Jack Alice and Yusei's cards. We got a negate, and we got a floodgate. So the idea here is you want to summon this on your turn, so that when you summon a second Crimson Dragon on their turn, it gets out this, and this will protect this from forcing it through. So, especially in a hand trap format, it should connect. And yeah, I mean, if you're staring down this, what the hell is your opponent doing, man? They're dead.
Yeah,
pretty much dead.
Yeah, true. That's crazy. There's a combo that you summon both of them?
So Crimson Dragon will summon Quasar during your turn, and then on their opponent's turn, you'll be summoning Quasar.
Crimson Dragon,
and Crimson Dragon will get out the Red Dragon.
To ensure that you're obviously protected from head traps and stuff like that.
Yeah, so this is just like your protection from breakers, like draw, and it's an impact droplet, but that's what Aegis is for as well. It gives several layers of protection because you're assuming you get hand trapped, you assume you're not getting the full field. Like, that's a bit extreme. But if you do, like, they need a lot of breakers to really stop it from, you know, panning out the way you want it to.
Yeah.
Next up, we got a generic Lynx for when you get into these scrappy game states that aren't normal. We don't get to resolve our synchro summons. Because not every card in here is a tuner. IPS VR is fantastic at doing that. It should be pretty obvious. Then we got Lina. So Lina isn't really that good. I mean, yes, you can get back their Veiler, but there's not too many white cards in the format. The real reason I want this is I want a Spellcaster Link 2 that I can turn to Selene, and Selene can be back any Spellcaster from my grave. So if I don't get access to level 12 Synchro, but I milled my Primeia, I can still lean back Primeia. So I still have ways to my Centurion deck engine without resolving this. Because if it was just this, then it'd be too easy to choke my deck at this point, and then it would fall apart. So by having two strategies, it means that two negates isn't the huge steal. And if I have two negates and this is what they stopped, this is still like Apo, and I could probably make an SP somewhere, IP. So like, you're still ending on disruptions through two hand traps.
Yeah.
At that point, I'm feeling pretty comfortable. And you assume like a shuffler in the mix as well. So yeah, Appaloosa, super convenient after Selene. I mean, it makes sense, right? And yeah. Installation hand traps as well. This one should be pretty obvious. Also good at IP target. Right. And then for the XYZs, because we are using all the colors here, so that's purple, I guess, we got Dugarrus. And the same way as Selene revives cards back, so does this. So we keep getting to our engine. It's just very hard for you to choke this deck from getting your combos in that method. Draw to discard one is also fine, but honestly, the revival effect is what you're typically using for. And the deck full of fours, this card is not hard to get out. And then for rare games where you do not get to get going because you just can't get mills, then you have Minerva. Honestly, this card is kind of outdated. So it's not like crazy. I mean, there are games where you mill three Light Horns and this feels like the best card ever printed.
Yeah.
But it's a lot more like high roll than you'd like. However, there are some games like it's this for this and the mill are better than the draw. So you just do this. And it's okay, but this card's not fantastic anymore. And the on-instruction effect's not bad for pushing through stuff either. And then Zombie Vampire as your rank 8 for obvious reasons for horse cards. The card is just insane. Now, for those who don't remember, you can also use cards you stole from your opponent as level 8. So if you wind like an Effect Veiler, you can treat the Effect Veiler as level 8. So specifically if you have like going second, or even if they just Veiler you turn 1, and you have this on the field, and you line another Veiler, you can turn those both into Zombie Vampire. And then afterwards, you can turn these into Selene if you have like the, I guess, Spellcaster and Graveyard Owner 5. So
amazing.
There are cool combo lines there. The last up is just Typhon. I like this card a lot in the format right now versus Snake Eye deck because they don't have the Gurnix to kill this. If you get them to deplete a lot of the resources on turn one, but they still have the Flame Burst and stuff to kill you, if you can make this clean up the field a little bit, it means that the only way to kill this is really like using the Promethean Princess into Zalantis OTK. So if you, as long as you can prevent that from happening, they have to use their battle phase to kill this, and it means you get another turn, which is oftentimes like the most important thing versus Snake Eye deck. They can't use Flame Burst to revive or Flame Burst to push this back. That is pretty much a big deal. So yeah, that's the deck, and it's super cool. I'm excited to do with it, so check back on this channel. I'm Dueling Sam, and he is going to get destroyed.
Unity Double Deck Box! Holographic design, inside and out! Each deck box includes three leather dividers, one metal field center, and one TSX-1 attribute dice. Get your limited deck box now at TSX1.com.
So I think I'm going to start with this Ditch This, because this is like easy Ash bait, and I very much expect him to Ash this. I would if I was playing against
this.
Yeah, like, obviously I already had King Sark, so it wouldn't pan out too well. That's why, like, drawing two was, like, fine. And even if I don't, I can always discard it off of the other King Sark. Look here. So I had a draw. Yeah, holy shit, that was really good. Okay, so what do I want to lead with? Do I lead with King Sark? Probably not. Because I don't need to discard if I mill another. This is a two-tuner, so I probably don't do this. I probably lead with Charge. And try get access to... what's it called? The Dragonling.
Wait, gosh, so you have to reset that.
This card is sent from deck to the graveyard, and you can set this card. Yeah, so I just have to make sure that it doesn't have to go by card effect, because Felice does. I do get to reset it. So if I want the Dragonwing here, I don't have a Light Warning Graves, I'd have to summon this first anyways. Maybe I will just do the horse cards first. I'm going to get Dragonwing either way, probably just better. And then this will get reset. Here, so let's put a face up. That'll be a negate for us. I want need to try end on the Light Warning card now. But it shouldn't be too much of a problem. Summon a King Sark. And I can revive the Horus. I'm Seti. And I can discard this to sound from the grave. Happy. And bring it out. And I mean, there was like a world where I could go for Gareth instead. But I think this is fine. So here I get to mill four.
So like, what are you trying to...
More Light Sworn cards, but I kind of want to save these for extenders for, like, if I get potentially nibbed. So I'd like to be able to play without having to use these, so I want to mill Light Sworns. Yeah. But, like, if I don't mill Light Sworn, then I can still play with these. It's just, yeah, because, like, this does, the issue is, like, if I start with these I have two tuners up.
Yeah.
So I have to summon this as well to make the synchro. And then I'm just summoning four monsters into Nibiru. So that's obviously like not ideal if you can avoid it. So mill four. Send it to Treon. Okay, well, I guess I'm just going for another tuner. That's kind of unfortunate. This is okay. Now let's think here. Okay. So let's use Vice. And I'll mill Felice. So it's the top of the deck, and I mill two. There's the tuner, non-tuner. So they'd have to nib me here. And if they do, then I still have this. And I can still play through. I also still have a normal summon. Our three spells engraved to set up for a Selene play if I get to that point. Either way from here, let's synchro summon these away. And we're going to make our Minerva. An effect to impact the grave. Now, I might not trigger two because my field is pretty full. It's still worth it. I'll send Wolf and Vice on what the non-tuners. And then both attacks will trigger. So I get back the Wolves. Get back the Vice.
Oh. Voice can revive back itself?
No, sorry. I cannot. And then, yeah, Minerva effects a mill here. I only have one different name, so mill one. Yeah, I'm mill one. For what it's worth. All right. It doesn't matter. And I want a synchro here. Yes, level 12. I can get Oxilla. Let's not put it in the end. That'd be stupid. And then from there, we can search for, what do we want to get? We can get, I should shuffle her here to put like the emblema, or the, sorry, this. Yeah. I could shuffle here to put this back in my deck. I probably need to put it back in the deck. So you know what, let's chain the shuffler here. Put this back. And there's probably all I need to put back, yeah. So I'll put this back and then I'll search it. Now, from here, I'm going to overlay these two and make Dugarrus. Now, I'm doing this because I need a card to discard for this. So I just want to draw a card, pretty much. It does not matter what I hit. I mean, either of these are useful. In fact, neither of them do literally anything. I guess it's this. That's fine, though.
So draw two, discard one, I'll do Dugarrus, right?
Yeah, draw two, discard one, and then from here, so still I have, so I can get this out, get Primera, and then I can go Primera, so if I want to go into Lina, into Selene, I don't need to burn the Lina though, I just go straight into Selene. This can add any Centurion card, so I think it's this, I think it's activate standoff, discard the recharge, to place from deck the Primera. And I'll special summon it. I'm not going to search here because I still want to be able to special summon it again this turn. And I'll make Selene. And then I'm going to special summon back the Primera. And then I'll search. I haven't normal summoned yet, so I can get...
Well, yeah, you haven't normal summoned at all.
Yeah, Trudea. I'll normal Trudea and use the effect. Place itself in there. And I'll place this in there. I can bring this out and put these away into Crimson Dragon. Bring this out. Oh, that's not the right card. That's, there you go.
Also, Crimson Dragon target this attack.
Yeah, make it level 12. This is still my hand. I'm still here for next turn. I guess this can be made into, is it IP better or Apo better? Because this can still revive. This will have so many counters. It can revive this again on his turn, which is kind of cool to synchro with, right? So there is merit to that. So what if I go instead, effect, send, Felice. I don't know, Felice comes out. Like I could just make Crimson Dragon again. And then that's it, but instead I'm going to make IP.
Yep.
And now the one thing is I didn't do field space if I want to make the next Crimson Dragon on their turn. but like the alternative is I don't use the effect of release. So I just have this. And then I go Appaloosa. I mean, this is still fine.
Oh, so you're setting release for not using its effect.
Yeah. Wheel end phase, put one back. So we'll put back. I guess Primera is fine. And then pass. Because we have the negate, because we have a thing here for anything. This is a negate. We have this up still. We'd millisecond shuffler, but that's fine. And then on their turn, we'll bring up both these. And this one goes to 8. One goes to 8. This one goes to 8. I don't know why it's my extra deck. And then Synchro for Crimson Dragon. We'll target the 12 again, and we'll get out. But again, wrong card. This one. And then they're locked out of the game. They cannot activate card effects.
Wow. So honestly, you're just trying to freestyle into an end board that's something similar to this.
Yeah, and you could have this in there somewhere. You could have this in there somewhere. You could have Shufflers in the Grave. Sometimes we have this in play. It kind of depends on what you mill, what you draw, and when hand traps get thrown at you, right? Like, in that sequence, we Zombie Vampire mills your opponent's deck as well, right? So if you hit a card that's good off them,
yeah,
that could also work to your favor, right? Or at the same time, if you mill a Light from their deck, or they Veiler you, or you mill a Nibiru, like,
true,
Lina, and that's good as well. So the options kind of do very much depend on what is happening in the game. But that's what's cool with this deck. It's not Snake Eye. It's not your memorized combos. It's you look for patterns you go for. And you freestyle to end on certain cards. Now, obviously, ending on this is kind of toxic, but that's so light forms in general are the freestyle thing. If you don't end on this, there are other ways to play this deck.
Okay, wow. This deck is absolutely insane. So honestly, I can imagine this deck going second is ridiculous at breaking.
Yeah, it's really strong. I mean, the biggest fear for this deck is Appaloosa, but that's where the horse cards help and why you have cards like Talents in there.
Okay. All right, just thank you so much for the design profile. Can't wait to showcase you guys some of the crazy duels that we have with this deck. Smash thumbs up on it. Check out Jesse Khan YGO in the link down below. All right, guys.
Peace.